Lord, it's been so good to me. He said, "My hand is still free of things are." Right. arrived yesterday, and they said, "Your white language, what people have seen on there." Also, I have your report. I've been having a little trouble when they run some tests. They got a membrane, and they found the spot. And they had to do a colonoscopy, and every time they done a bone scan, because they thought my bad, I have osteoporosis. They done a test, used to it. They done one, it was clear. They said, "We got to do it." And they done it, there's nothing there.
It could have been a whole lot worse, but the doctor said it was just a drive-by, and that was good.
I might have. Someone else?
I got a prayer.
Come on, sis.
Actually, I got two.
That's fine.
I was sitting when Jeff came down, but I heard that you guys had prayer with him, and we've been going through a really tough time with some things there at home, and we're pretty desperate, you know, for the situation. And I went on Facebook Thursday after that. And I was going to request prayer because, you know, I'm sorry. I was going to request prayer from everybody. And in the middle of the time,
Thank you. blessed heaven, dear God. Right up in heaven, I praise your holy name for what you're doing in Ellen's life, dear God. I praise your holy name, God, for the wonderful things we have in this church. I just praise your holy name for all the blessings that you're bestowing on us. And I love him and I praise his holy name. God's going to bless you. God's going to bless you tonight with the message I can feel with you. I praise his holy name, Kim. I love Jesus with all my heart. He means all of me. I tell you what, I praise his holy name. I love him. I love him for what he is and who he is. He is, he's everything to me, man. Hey, I love y'all. Something big is going to happen here tonight. If I be low, saying it's going to be a great big healing, but it ain't no secret what God can do. Amen. What your brothers can do for you.
Amen.
God pray for me and I always do what God has to do. God bless you.
Amen. Amen.
All we know is that it's
is only one salvation.
Inside of that tomb. Easter, but praise God, Easter is every day inside of my heart. Because I know Jesus rose from the grave on the third day. And I know he lives inside of me. Amen. And I know, Johnny, he's coming back again for me one day after a while. All of the praise reports we've heard here goes right along with what I've been studying. Now I know why I've been studying and what I've been studying today. When God called me to pray into the ministry, I said, Lord, here am I. I'm going to open my mouth every time that I'm up in this pulpit, and you're going to let the Holy Ghost speak through. Because that's what he promised he would do. Today, when I was studying, I want to ask you all this question. Can he see your faith? And I believe there's a lot of people that's already testified to the fact tonight that he has seen your faith. Amen. I believe he saw Sister Rhonda's faith when she was laying in the bed down there and had the prayer cloth in her hand. Amen. I believe he saw Sister Martha's faith when she gave her testimony a minute ago. I believe he sees my faith in what I'm going through right now. No matter what you're going through, I want you to really take this serious, because this is something that God has given me over a period of time. I studied on this a long time ago, and I was waiting for the right time for God to give it to me. He said, "Today, this is the time." But I want to give you a little story in the Bible. Jesus was in a room, okay, he was in a house, and he was preaching. There was four men came along, and they brought a man that was paralyzed to him. This man was laying in a bed, okay, he was paralyzed, he couldn't walk, so they had to have somebody to carry him there. Right. Now, there was such a crowd around Jesus. His fame had already grown, he was so popular, there was such a crowd around Jesus, they couldn't get to him. What kind of church would we be in here in this building? How many of you think this building would hold 150, 200 people? Well, probably more than that. We've had 200 people in here, so a little over 200 people probably. You imagine if we get 300, 400 people in this place and somebody needed something of the Lord, what would it be like? Think about it. Because the aisles, we've had a Christmas place here with chairs in the aisles and on the sides where you can't hardly even get up this aisle. And we praise God for that. But the aisles would be plumb full of people. That's the kind of setting that this was in the house when Jesus was preaching. They brought this man to be healed because he wanted to be healed, okay? And these four men, I don't know who they were that was carrying that bed. That's right. It don't say anywhere in the Bible who they were. But they had so much faith that Jesus could heal this man. Let me tell you what kind of faith they had. When they realized they couldn't get to him, you know what they did? They climbed up on top of the house. Now, that's some faith. Because they realized they could climb on top of that house. They could remove the roof right over top of where Jesus was and lower this man down to them. That's the kind of faith we need. Amen. That's the kind of faith we need if we want to get our prayers answered. Amen. The Bible says that here's what I'm getting to. When Jesus saw their faith, that's the only time in the Bible that I've ever read where Jesus saw faith. He saw the faith of these four men. And he said, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now this story has a twofold meaning to me. Because he told him that his sins were forgiven him. Well, you know how these old scribes are. You know how people murmur and they start going on and on. They was looking for any reason in the world anyway to get Jesus and prosecute him. And take him before the judge. Take him before the king. They was looking for anything. They thought, here's our opportunity. What in the world is he talking about? Forgiving sins. Why is he blaspheming like this? Only God can forgive sins. That's the way they was thinking. When Jesus realized what they were thinking, he said, would it be easier for me to say, get up out of your bed and walk? Or would it be easier for me to say, your sins are forgiven?
That's right.
Right. But he said, just so you will believe, I'm going to do this. I'm going to give you the second part of his miracle. He said, son, rise up, get up and take up your bed and walk. Yeah. Ain't that some faith? That is some faith. That's the kind of faith you and I need if we're going to have our prayers answered. Yeah. Sister Rhonda, I believe without a doubt that we had that kind of faith this morning. Right. We prayed for him. We all felt something go through. We felt a charge from heaven when we prayed that prayer for you. She went down to have her test done, and look what's happened. Look what the Lord has done. Amen. Our God is so great. This is how great he is and how loving he is. He said if you have a faith, have you ever seen a mustard seed? How small that is. If you have that much faith, you can tell that mountain to move. Amen. Now, I believe that's talking about spiritual mountains, but any mountain that you have in your life, the doctor called Ron and said, we need you to get here as soon as possible, next morning, have a catheterization. We saw something. We found something in her test. But we prayed the prayer of faith. We had the faith as a grand mustard seed, and I believe she had something in her. And I believe God healed her, whatever it was inside her. Whatever was going on in that heart, God healed her right there. I believe last Sunday when Jay was here, we had prayer for him. And we had already prayed for Jay before he even got here. Amen. And the choir was singing and looked back and lo, here comes old Jay walking in the door. And we all, inside, I was just rejoicing because I saw Judy rejoice. That was God answering a prayer right there. And they've got the great news they've got because why? Because they had faith as a grand mustard. God saw their faith. I don't know what you're going through in life, in your life, but you know, God, he told us that if anything we ask of him, in faith believing, we can have it. He promised us this. Just got to believe. And the last 3 years I've went through a personal battle myself where my faith has been tested. My faith has been tried. Well, yeah, it has. More than it ever has in my life. I've had some trials of faith, but now this one has been the tallest. This is Mount Everest. I mean, this is the tallest mountain I've ever faced. But I have, and I told Mom this a few times. I said, you know, it's a weird thing that I went through because it's been a hard battle, but I have never lost my faith. Yeah, I've had times where I get discouraged and I get upset. We all do. We're in the flesh. We all do. But I've never lost my faith that God's going to handle what's going on. Never, ever lost my faith. And I'm going to tell you something. This summer, some of you in here already know what I'm going to say, but this summer, I don't know where it came from or how it happened, but I know it happened. God made a way where there seemed to be no way. He parted. Hey, he parted the Red Sea in my family's life. We was up against the waters, and Pharaoh's army was just about to take us under. We didn't have no idea what was going to happen next. Hey, we was getting ready to leave here. We was going to have to leave here. I'll just be honest. And we'd already made plans. After Bible school, got to go look for other things. And because we have to provide for our family. But it was a matter, I'm telling you, in 2 days, God made a way. And he parted that Red Sea. He allowed us to go through that water on dry land. And he brought the waters in on Pharaoh's army and drank them. Amen. That's God. Amen. That's God. Why? Because he saw my faith. I believe with all my heart he saw my faith. And he saw Emily's faith. He saw my kids' faith, I believe. We was really praying not to have to leave here because I know these kids, they don't want to leave school. Emily don't want to leave here. I don't want to leave here. We had to do something, though. And we just felt like it was going to be our only option. But God, I'm praise God that he made a way. And I thank him today and I love him supremely above everything in this world. I don't know what else to say, but this has been an awesome service. I didn't know what I come in here and told Mom. I don't know where I'm going tonight, but I was studying on that today, but I didn't know that was what was coming out. But I come here and I heard all these praise reports. I said, I know where I'm going tonight. That was my confirmation, because I believe God will give you confirmation sometimes when you have a question. My confirmation was hearing all these praise reports. I asked Danielle back here, I said, was today better? Because she testified yesterday was a rough day for her. And I said, was today better? She said, oh yeah, it was good. It was a good day. And I praise God for that, because I prayed for her this morning. I prayed that God will make things better for her. And I just thank God that he answers prayers.
Amen.
You know, and I don't want to bring anybody down, but now, there was a few years ago, our family's faith was, the way Gina put it, our family's faith was shaking. Because we just knew Mike was coming home.
Yeah.
We knew it was going to happen. You know, we had all the faith believing in those prayers we had. I even stood up one time in the waiting room and spoke out when we was getting ready to have a circle prayer for him. And I told him, I said, we don't have to accept this, because the doctor was giving us bad news. I said, listen, y'all, we don't have to accept this. I said, let's pray and let's have faith. God can change this. God can make a change in this.
Yes, he can.
And he did for a couple few more days. But I don't know why we had to go through what we had to go through down there. That's one of those things we'll understand when we get there. I can't wait to get there and ask Mike. I believe he already knows why he went through what he went through. But, you know, he was so excited about going to heaven. Anybody that was here when he was here, he always talked about wanting to kick up some goldie dust. And there ain't no doubt in my mind, him and Cat Wall is dancing up a storm over there. I believe it's a dust storm. And I'm thankful that we have that hope, you know, because Mike left a testimony and a smile on his face. And you know where Mike went. You know, you just know where he, just sometimes people leave like that. Sister Dolly, you just know where they went. I mean, you know, there's no doubt. And I don't know their hearts, but you got to know, you know. But I'm thankful that Mike left the way he did, and I'm thankful that we got the hope that we could go to him. I wish he could come back to us. We didn't want him to leave us yet, but hey, we could go to him.
Right.
And it's not going to be very long. Our life is just a vapor. Yeah. It appears for a little season, and then vanishes away. I'm 43 years old, and it seems like just yesterday I was running up and down the camp like Gracie is now, and playing football and playing basketball, and she's out there cheering and doing gymnastics and stuff, but I was playing sports out in the camp. It just seemed like it was just yesterday. Time is so short, and I'm sure you guys can testify to the same thing. But I'm glad, talking about Mike, you know, and what we mourned. We mourned the deaths of all of our loved ones. But I'm glad, like David said in Psalms, he turns my mourning into dancing. And he does, because I rejoice in the fact, not the hope, not only the hope, but the fact that I could go see him again. And I could go see Mike, I could go see Jane, I could go see my mom, papa, and granny, and papa. But the main one I want to see is my Jesus. He's the one that gave me life. He's the one that gave me eternal life. Yes, it's the first one I want to go to. But I don't know if I'll get to him for a million years. But if it takes me a million years, I'm still going to go talk to him. Right? I want to hug his neck, and I want to kiss his feet. I want to be one of them that anoints his feet with the fragrant oil, you know, like the little woman did. There's another thing that Jesus saw faith in. This woman came to him in the room, and she stood behind him because they had a custom when they knelt down at to eat or whatever at the table that they would kneel on their knees and down on the floor, you know. This woman come behind him. She was a sinner. She come behind him and washed his feet with her tears, and she dried them with her hair. She kissed his feet. She anointed his feet with oil, with fragrant oil. And you know, the disciples looked at him and said, do you want us to send her away? Why are you letting the sinner wash your feet like you do these things? And he said, you know, when I came, I think it was Peter he was talking to. He said, when I came into your house, you didn't give me a kiss. She has not ceased to kiss my feet when I walked out. You didn't wash my feet. She hasn't ceased to wash my feet with her tears and dry with her hair. And you didn't anoint my head with oil, but she has not ceased to anoint my feet with fragrant oil. That That is faith. And he told her, he said, woman, your sins are forgiven.
That's right.
Your faith has made you whole. He saw that woman's faith. And he saved her right there on the spot. I don't know if I thought too today of a thief on the cross. I don't know why I'm going on all thoughts. Think about this one for a minute. The thief hanging on a cross. Jesus was just about to die. He was struggling for every breath. One of the thieves, they ridiculed him, and he just he went on and on about him, persecuting him or whatever. And he said, if you're the Christ, why don't you come down off the cross and save yourself? And save us too. The other thief spoke up and he said, do you not fear God? See, we are in the same condemnation. But this man's done nothing. He knew this man had done nothing to deserve what he was given. To deserve the death, the cruelest death in the world on the cross. And he looked at Jesus and he said, Lord, and I believe at that time, just y'all can believe what you want. This is just me. When I was reading and studying on this, can he see your faith thing today? I really got kind of a revelation to him that I believe their eyes met. And I believe he looked at Jesus. I don't say that. They don't say that they looked at each other. But I believe he looked at Jesus, and I believe Jesus turned to him. And he said, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Right there on the cross, Jesus saw the faith of a thief, an old sinner. And he said, verily I say unto you, today you will be with me in paradise. That man's sins were forgiven him. That man was saved. And I believe he went to paradise with him. Wherever paradise is, that's where he went. Amen. He's with Jesus, so he's in heaven to me. That's what I believe. And I don't know if heaven is on earth or if heaven is in the outer space. I don't really care. As long as Jesus is there, it's going to be heaven. Amen. As long as I'm not burning and I'm not tormenting, it's going to be heaven. As long as I ain't where Satan is, it's going to be heaven.
Amen.
I ain't going to get into that Satan and hell thing. I'll get into that another time. Just study on that, if you will. Can Jesus see your faith? We got to really get stern and get earnest and get strong in our faith with the Lord.
Amen.
Just think about it and pray about it. If you have, how many times did Jesus look at people in the Bible and say, oh, you have little faith? Wonder how many times he said that to us if he said it to them. You know? I thought of that today too. I mean, if he told those people that, these people didn't have TVs to distract them. Call it sin or don't call it sin. I mean, you know, to do good and don't do it is sin, right?
That's right.
They didn't have these little laptops and iPads and iPhones to distract them. They was sin in the world. There was sin in the world, but it wasn't like it was today. And if he told them you have little faith, I wonder how many times he just shook his head up on his throne and says, oh, you little faith. Because we doubt so much. And I believe we doubt more than those people did back in the Bible days. And I was thinking about that today, you know, how many times he said that to us. But if you catch yourself thinking that you are lacking in faith and you feel like you're low in faith, pray. Pray, pray, pray. I don't know how much I can stress it to you anymore, a prayer life of any Christian, not just preachers, not just deacons, not just leaders in the church, a prayer life is so important to each Christian. If you start lacking in your prayer life, listen, I'm telling you this from experience, if you start lacking in your prayer life, things will start getting bad. Your faith will start wavering. Your belief will start wavering. You'll see stuff on these Discovery channels and Science channels that'll make you wonder, it can happen. Believe me. Because the devil is so convincing of going against everything that the Holy Bible says. He is so convincing at going against everything that we as Christians believe. So we got to be on our toes. Amen. We gotta put on the whole armor of God. And we gotta have that shield of faith to hold out there. Because there is so many darts, fiery darts coming at you from evil, from the devil, from evil spirits. Bobby talked about the other, he preached on the other night. That was a great message. I enjoyed that message. Because I've talked to Christians that don't believe in evil spirits, and I don't know why they believe that, but because the Bible is plain about this stuff. And I have heard Christians say that they don't believe there's evil spirits today, but I believe they're out there. What else is it tempting you? And what else is it tempting me to sin, or throwing doubts in my way, or throwing disbelief at me because I'm going through a hard time for 3 years? What else is that that's coming at me? That's an evil spirit trying to get me to doubt my faith. That's an evil spirit trying to get me to doubt that my Jesus is still King and He still has all power. Amen? He's got all power to do what He wants. God is God, right? He can do what He wants. That's what I say that all the time when we go out and sing and I'll testify. I say, hey, God is God. He can do what He wants. I ain't going to sit here and say He can't do something, or He can't do this, or can't call this one a preacher, or can't call that one a preacher. I ain't going to sit there and say that because He's God. He can do what He wants. Amen. He's not subject to me. I'm subject to Him. Amen. I don't have that kind of authority to sit here and say that you're going to hell for this, you're going to hell for that. I don't have that authority. I got authority just to warn you to flee from that evil tormentor. That's all I have. Amen. If I tell you something that's in that Bible, that's all the authority I got. Because God's already gave you authority. God has already gave that judgment. If He says it's an abomination, it's an abomination. And it ain't only old law. It ain't only Old Testament. That is in the whole Bible. It's all the way through it. That homosexuality is an abomination. That killing babies is an abomination. It don't say murder is an abomination, I don't believe. But there is a commandment that says thou shalt not kill. How can you sit and justify anything to do with that? Whether it's already been born or whether it's not. It's a baby. If it's in a mother's womb, it's a baby. And it has life in it. If any of y'all have ever watched, I wish I watched it once, and I wish a thousand times I never would have watched that. About a partial birth and abortion. I saw a video of it, and it just tore me up inside. Because I think I put myself in that position. I looked at my babies, and I thought, wow. How in the world can anybody do that? I don't know how a doctor could be a doctor and live with that, you know? I mean, killing babies, homosexuality, that's just a couple of the big things that's going on in the world today that are evil, pure evil. And I don't know, we gotta think about what I'm saying. Think about, can Jesus see your faith? I'm gonna get away from all that. Think about, can Jesus see your faith, okay? And If you need strength in your life, and like I said, I can't stress it enough, pray. If you need more faith, pray for it. Pray about it. Because He will grant you your heart's desire. And if you desire to have faith and have wisdom, He will grant that to you. Study the Word and pray the prayer, okay? That's all I got. I don't know.
Amen. Now the Lord works. He knows I told Josh I wish I'd been there and prayed. Come up the road this evening to take care of me. The lawnmower stopped to get gas, and that's youth group right there at the little general store. And we had prayer right out there in the parking lot.
Amen.
And it restored my faith, and I thank the Lord for it.
Thank you, Brother Lord.
They got a lot going on down there with floodwaters and stuff. And to come up here and not know me for nothing, and come to my house and pray with me, with the Lord,
amen.
God bless you. Yeah. And only God could have seen them.
That's right.
And I don't care what anybody says. Have faith in Him, believe in Him, He's coming, and He's better than the grave.
Amen. 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 Listen to the words of this song Brother Roger's going to sing. Tonight, if you're here, you feel like you're standing alone, I want you to picture something in your mind that Jesus is right here with his hands outstretched. All he's asked is come to me. Take a hold of his big hand spirit in your heart. Take a hold of it. And you'll not have to walk alone anymore. Listen to the words of this song.
Church, if you would stand with us just for a moment, let's give an invitation. Brother Kevin has done a wonderful job here with the Holy Spirit to send the message out tonight. Can you see your faith? Unsaved, if you will come to this altar tonight, according to the Bible, God will give you a measure of faith. What does that mean, preacher? That means that he will give you the faith to believe that he was the Son of God, that you're on your way to heaven. If you want that tonight, you can have it. You can feel what everybody was feeling in this room. I don't know if there's any lost in the room or not. But if you are, you need to come.
I thought.
You need to come.
Number one.
Come on, Roger.
Put surely.
Why don't you sleep down your seat? Come on.
I've gone.
And if you got something you want to pray about tonight, Father, if you've been a Christian 30 years, you come down and you pray about it.
I would be on life's sinking sand, but I can't even crawl without.
I don't know if we have any lost here, but you're in the right place. If you've lived for him before, you know what it's like. You know what it feels like to have that peace, that joy inside of you. You can have it again. If you turn your back on him, you can have that again. It's so simple just to come back to Father's house.
As a mighty big man.
He didn't leave you. He was the one who left. Just ask him back into your life. Amen.
Without you holding
is there one?
My hand. Lord, I can't even walk.
Yeah, you ready to just feel it. Too. Your faith getting weak, if your faith wavering. Come on, come and ask for a charge. Yeah, you get a charge. Amen. Down on your knees is how you need to learn to stand. Amen.
Will you come?
Yeah.
I'll make Jesus.
Yeah.
Make Jesus my own.
Yeah,
I believe
from now on. Yeah. When I'm in trouble,
are you going to call
on
him?
Name, I'll call
him. Call on
him. If I didn't trust him.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'd be less than a man.
You need an answer to anything tonight?
Cause I can't even walk.
Ask and you shall receive.
Thank you.
number one. Would surely be me. I thought I could be what I wanted to be. I thought I would be on life's sinking sand, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Well, I thought I could do,
yes, Lord,
a lot. Thank you.
Somebody else have a need.
Oh,
it's been a good place. I don't think the Lord's done yet. Amen.
Of myself. As a mighty big man. It's on His name I'll call. If I don't trust
Him, amen.
I'd be less than a man. Lord, I can't even walk without You holding my hand.
We saw faith increase in this room tonight, didn't we?
I saw people raise their hands that hadn't raised their hands in a while. I saw some tears flowing from some eyes in here that I haven't seen tears in your eyes.
Praise the Lord.
That makes me happy. Now we got a young man back here that's going to sing us a song. So if you want to be, go ahead and be seated. And he's got a special surprise for you. And I'm going to introduce him to you. Make him welcome, Cody Rhodes.
Church, y'all just pray for him because the devil's been working on me all day. I've been practicing this song. And he's been saying, no, you ain't going to do it. Wait another time. Wait. You ain't going to do it. And I know God's telling me to go ahead and do it because who knows what will happen.
Bless the Lord.
I had a vision. What my eyes they did see as I viewed way up yonder in that sweet eternity. I thought I entered that city and stopped by the gate. I couldn't hardly wait. As I entered that city, Jesus stood by the door, said, my child, you are welcome, and you're saved forever.
Church.
Why don't you look all around you and see who you can see? For you've had so many loved ones that have gone ahead of you. So I walked on a little farther. Who is that I see? Why, there's my brother Randy. So many times he befriended me and he held me in my sickness and in trouble a helping hand. Why, that's him singing in that blessed angel way.
Blessed Lord. Thank you, Lord.
So I walked on a little farther. Who is that I see? Why, there's my sister Jo. Lord, she led ahead of me, but I wonder if she'll remember me. She's been gone for so long, but with a smile she remembered, saying, Cody, you're welcome home. Oh yes, over yonder is some faces I remember still. It's the old-fashioned preachers from the church upon the hill with their Bibles. I still see them. And so many times I've seen before, telling me of heaven, where I live forevermore. So I'll just keep right on walking many paces more, for there are so many faces that I'm looking for. But I won't have to worry, I can take all the time I need.
Bill would like for us to pray with him. He's been going through a lot of problems. He wants his family back the way it was. He's dedicated his heart to Jesus. He's determined he's going to turn to heaven. If you believe God can mend broken homes, you come on up here and you pray with us, okay? If you don't think he can do this, don't come. Just stay back here. Because we want people that believe he's going to do it. And I believe he will. He's going to work in his time. He may go home tonight, get a phone call, I'm coming home. There may be a week, I don't know. God works in his time. But I believe God's going to give him his heart's desire. Bill? Sorry if I call you, but I know everybody knows you, but you're a big I'd rather call you Bill. I know you have, brother. Yes, you have, son. God, you got you going back the other way now. You got that new job down there? Yeah. And he saved your soul? Number one thing, ain't it? Number one thing.
Amen. I got back last house and he said, we're going to work. I said, we'll fight first.
There you go, brother. There you go.
We're going to work first.
That's the right attitude.
And it's
changed. Yeah.
I told my wife, I said, it's time for a change, you know?
Yeah.
I lost her 5 months
ago.
It's
years. Yeah. What is wrong with that?
I know, son. I believe God's going to mend it.
I passed out one day. I locked the lock for 2 days. I didn't say a song. I didn't tell about you to bring people who I was saying. And I should have did that, but no. Nick Horner, no. Absolutely positive, no. But the greatest thing I ever done is give my life to the Lord.
Thank you,
my
man. Amen.
And it's like now, like my grandma always told me, she said, you know, when she's going to get your family, she said, you know, the ones might be a little different. Where it might be a little softer. You know what? Since the ideas we have to.
Let's come to the Lord and ask God to hear this prayer. What's that? Heavenly Father, we come to you as we can. Lord, we want to pray. We need to put all of our hearts, soul, mind, and strength. All of us gathered around. We're going to be with you tonight. We want to ask you to touch the Lord of this heart. God, touch this prayer with you. See his faith tonight. We're camping the rest of the Lord. We ask that you see where faith is in the hearts of the people. And God, we pray for you. Just be with that together. God, we can look at this Lord.
In the valley to
it's any gooder than this, we're going to get to heaven.
Amen. Come on, Bob.
You know, we might just be one heartbeat away.
That's right.
One breath. And we'll be there. I read in the Bible where a certain man named Lazarus said he died. And he was carried away by the angels. And taken and laid in Father Abraham's bosom, a place of paradise. That's what heaven is, a place of paradise. And there was another man died, and it said he was buried, and he opened his eyes up, and he was in a flame. He was in hell. Because he didn't believe God. He didn't have the Lord in his life. But I got the Lord in my life. How many's got the Lord in your life in here today? Amen? All right. This is so great. So good. This revival has been good for the church.
Amen.
Monday night there was two came and gave their life to the Lord. We thank God for that.
Amen.
We've seen healings. We've seen faith restored. We've seen spirits lifted. We've seen joy put on people's face. I saw some smiles come back that I hadn't seen in a while. And I thank God for it. And some of you have got to attend more services through this revival. You got to attend more than you've got to attend in a pretty good while, haven't you? And I've seen people grow. Some of you young Christians that have been in church a year or less, and maybe just a little bit longer, I've seen your faith increase. I told Katie the other night up here, I said, I've seen her grow more in the last 4 or 5 months than I have in a long, long time. You know why? Because she started stepping out and saying, what can I do? She's come and asked, what can I do? She says, Brother Kevin, what can I do? And Kevin said, well, we can give you some jobs around here in the church. She said, I want to do something for the Lord. That's why her faith has increased. That's why her blessings are coming like they are. Cody, didn't he do a good job on that? Tell I want to do one, Maggie. But you've done wonderful, brother. He did a wonderful job, and that's such a tribute to Maggie Rhodes. Everybody knows she's in a nursing home now, and she's got Alzheimer's. But I believe if she'd walk in there and start talking about Jesus, she'd probably know who you're talking about. I remember when me and Eddie and Paul Vanover went to see Martha's mom, Sister Bessie. She had Alzheimer's and didn't know her family most of the time. She probably didn't know us. But we got to talk about Jesus, and she knew who that man was. Her eyes opened wide, her ears perked up. She knew all about it. Paul said, well, we're going to pray, Sister Bessie. We're going to talk to Jesus. She said, okay, we're going to talk to Jesus. She knew who Jesus was. And I'm glad I know who Jesus is.
Amen.
The hardest thing about having revival is when you come to a close. We're coming to a close tonight. We're going to rest a little bit tomorrow night, and then we're going to be right back out here Sunday at 10:30 for Sunday school. And Sunday night, Brother Wayne Runyon is scheduled to be here at 3. The service will start at 7. And then we got our homecoming coming up in September. The first Sunday of September will be a 2 o'clock service, and the next Sunday is going to be a 11 o'clock service. And that's when Brother Kevin's going to preach our homecoming this year. In October, we got another Saber service coming up, and I'm going to put him in that too. We're going to break him in on all these services. We're going to see if he's ready. Then come December, his time is going to be up to be ordained. And then in December, we're going to have an ordination service here. And I'm going to say if he holds on, because he's going to hold on. After what got a hold of him the last several times he preached, ain't no way he can look back. No way. That's right.
The devil told me that all day. I come here to church Wednesday. I bet there were 7 or 8 people told me I'm going to stay enjoying it.
Amen.
I'm not saying that to say that to boast or brag on it, but I'm saying that because you guys don't know what that means to me. And that showed me that the devil is a liar.
That's right.
And God is true.
That's right.
How many of us tired? How many of you is tired of praising God?
No.
Never get tired of it.
Y'all want to give him some more praise? Can you kids do a couple songs tonight before we go?
They told me that.
They kept prepared to do a couple of songs for you. Yeah. The service just went the way it went because God is God.
That's right.
That ain't their fault. We don't apologize. We're going to let these kids get up here. You can get your worship on if you got anything in. I know you got some men, but I saw them. Praise the Lord, Jerry.
And you know, to be honest with you, I don't remember the church. I was in the late 80s. And as I was going through it, the bedroom door was off the fence. You need to go to church.
Spirit of the Lord is here. Anybody feel it tonight?
When you feel like, man, my faith is so weak, I can't go another mile. God sees that too. The faith of a grain of mustard seed. Sam Mullen brought a little bottle down here, I think it was, with some mustard seed in it one time. I believe it was Sam. And he gave some of them out to some of the people in here. And it's a little old speck. Real hard to say. It's a little old tiny black speck. But Jesus described it like this, said, if you had the faith of a grain of mustard seed, which is the smallest of all seed, but when it is planted, it grows up into the greatest of all herbs, and the fowls of the air light and rest in it. Can the people of Buffalo Creek rest in your faith? There's another message, so we better look. We're glad for everyone that came this way tonight. I hope that down through the week you've got a blessing. I hope you've been a blessing. And I hope you receive what you came looking for. I said this is going to end the revival for the week. We're planning another one before the year ends. God willing, we'll have us another one. And just keep praying about that. And if it's not God's will, we'll get back at it in March probably. But we're going to do what God wants to do. Pray for your church. Pray for your pastor.
Pray for
your church. Always need it. Pray for your deacons and pray one for another, would you?
Amen.
Amen. And for those of you that raised your hand down through the week, we'll not forget you.
Amen.
We're praying for you. Most of all, Jesus saw the hands. And he won't give up on you. Amen. Everybody minded the Lord.
Amen.
Would you stand? With bowed heads in reference to the Lord, I'm going to take the honor of praying the dismissal prayer. Lord Jesus, we come to the close of another revival, Lord. We thank you for the souls that we saw at the altar. Not only the ones, Lord, that repented and came to know you as their personal Savior, but for every soul down through the week that came up to this altar and laid their burdens down. Lord, that trust you, and I know you see their faith, got to hear and answer their prayer. I thank you, Lord, for the healings that we saw take place. Lord, for the praise reports down through this week and especially tonight, just one after the other, of how good the great position on high has been to our people. Lord, we want to praise you for the blessings you bestowed upon the Lundale Church, God and its congregation, and all those that came. We don't believe there's any visitors in the house of God. We believe everybody's family. But God, for those that may attend other churches and they come here down through the week, my prayer, Lord, that they were blessed, that they felt welcome, that they felt at home, because certainly we should feel at home in the house of God. We should feel comfortable. We should feel among family when we come to your house, and that's the way we want this church, Lord, and its members to present. When anybody comes for their first time, we want them to feel welcome, feel like they're right at home. God, I ask you to continue your blessings upon Brother Allen and his ministry. Brother Kevin Moore and the ministry you've called him into. Lord, for every singer that came down through this week, I ask for your blessings upon them, Lord, for their sacrifices. Lord, for their commitment to singing the praises of God. We believe that the songs are seasoning for the anointed message that comes. For Lord, how can they hear without a preacher? And the anointed word of God is indeed the bread and the manna that we can feast on. Continue, Lord, I pray, to bless every one of my brothers and sisters that are under the sound of my voice here tonight. And as we leave this building tonight, God, take us all safely home to our different home of abode, and we'll bring us back at the appointed time. May God bless. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Good night, everybody. Amen.